Well, I was doing everything, but we performed in. We went to. We arrived in Rio first. We were in Rio de Janeiro, and when I went to the theater, the first day, you know, you look at the board and see what the rehearsal is. And it said Brown, Copacan, and Massine. Well, I was the only Brown there, so I went. And I went by myself, and I said, well, what is this? And he said, I'm doing a new ballet, and I want to do it on you because you learn everything so quickly, and you remember. Oh, I was thrilled to death. I work like a dog. We didn't have a union then. There was no union. And I worked. And I loved it. I loved every minute of it. And it was to Wagner music. It was, I've forgotten the name of that too. You have to remember that I've forgotten a lot, but it all comes back to me. So we rehearsed through that. Then when we came back to New York, he wanted me to teach everybody, even the soloists, their part. Dolly did the costumes for this ballet. So I taught everybody, and then I said to Mr. Massey, well, what do I do? He said, well, he said, I've kept you because you know everything. So if someone can't dance, you can go in. Well, when Dolly came with the costumes, one of the soloists, her name was Luba Rostova, tall, slender, very elegant looking. And her costume was black tights and a black leotard. And the whole leotard had been cut out like this. And she had breasts. And Dolly had painted nude. She had breasts with nipples, the 2-inch nipples, you know, red on it. She said, I'm not going to put that on. And Mr. Messing said, well, you have to put it on. This is a rehearsal. She said, I'm not going to wear it. He said, Vida. So I took one look at it. I'm 16 years old. I took one look at that thing and thought, oh, well, okay. If I have to do it, I'll do it. So I went up, put the costume on, came down in a robe, and they were having rehearsal. I mean, it was only in a rehearsal. And so when I heard the music, I took off the robe, and I went out. We wore high heels. So I just walked. It was mostly posing, you know. And then the guy came, and he took me, and he did something with me. But I knew what he was doing. That was fine. I walked. And so Mr. Messing said, thank you very much. Thank you. And so Luba came, and she said, well, she said, I'll try it. So I never got to do it, but I just did it that. But I was glad that I was out of it. But that was the sort of thing that happened with it. And then after, I think it was after about 3 years with the company, and that's when we joined a union. And of course, I was an American, and they approached me about, in the Corps de Ballet, about this, and I thought it was a great idea. And of course, that was like this for the Russians. They didn't know anything about it, and they didn't want it. But so anyhow, Mr. Massine was asked to go to ballet theater for a while, and so George Balanchine came in to replace him, and that's when I met him first. Was there, and my first meeting with him, you can call it a meeting. He was so wonderful to work with because you could hear a pin drop during the rehearsals. And I usually read because I was in the corps and I knew what I was doing. But then he started choreographing and I, you know, was sitting there reading and the music stopped and, you know, I kept reading. I didn't look up at anything. And everyone, all of a sudden, I looked up. Somebody said, Vida. And I looked up. Everybody's looking at me. And Mr. Balanchine is standing there waiting. And he said, you know, come. So I looked around. I said, me? And he said, yes. And he gave me a part in serenade, Tchaikovsky serenade. Oh, it was so lovely. Four other girls. But I loved it, you know. And I worked so hard. You know, he was so nice to me. He was so good to me. I adored him. When he was with us for 2 years, and he'd say to me, "Oh, I have a good part for you." And I said, "What is it?" "It's a nursemaid." Okay, so it was a nursemaid. And then he had another part. He wanted me to do it. And I noticed that it was never really dancing. You know, I knew everything. And when people hurt themselves, he put me in. And in one ballet in Pas de Dix, I remember, I learned it very fast. And then there was a solo, and I knew the solo. So I said, "And what about the solo?" He said, "No, the solo we're going to cut." I said, "Why? I can do it. I'll do it." So he said, "Vida, you are great. You're marvelous. We're going to cut that solo. It's too long anyhow." But I knew then. You know, he adored me. He put me in love because I was quick. But I wasn't his dancer.
What was his dancer then?
Like Helen. Long legs, long neck, and beautiful feet. He had a lot. He worked very, very hard with adagio dancers to make them do faster. You know, battement and this. He would work in class because he taught all the classes. And I could see that he was trying to get them to do it. It was difficult for them. But I realized that I wasn't his dancer, you know. So, and when he did a mazurka, when we came back to New York, this was much later, but he did a mazurka because he wanted to bring people in, and he performed with them, and he chose me to dance with him. So that was an honor, you know. Wasn't very good, though. He was standing on stage, and I said, "Mr. B, you're on stage." He said, "But the music's so..." I said, "Well, you can tell them later, but you can't do it now." The first time I went to London was right after the war was on.
So this was when
I left Ballet de la Jeunesse at that point and went to London. I think we'd been in London. And I stayed there. Because that's war broke out and they took the company, this whole Ballet de la Jeunesse, they took the whole company to the seaside, West Mercy, Essex. And we were given, you know, a hotel or billets, you know, we had these little things on the beach. And we could hear the planes coming over. And we get out and see, and everybody kept saying, they're the Brits. You know, it's not the Germans. And then I made contact with Sir Pathick Lawrence, not Emmeline. I met her. But he took me, I remember, to the House of Commons. And I was hearing this speech, and here the war was on. The war had been on. And I said to him, "What are they discussing?" And he said, "They're discussing the tourism and whether they should have ice in the water for the tourists." So I said, "The ice and water with the war on?" I couldn't believe it.